Hello, comrades, and welcome back to Ushanka Show. Здравствуйте, дорогие товарищи. В эфире программа Ushanka Show. My name is Sergey, and I was born in the USSR. Меня зовут Сергей, и я родился в Советском Союзе.
This guy may have actually grown up in the USSR, but he's still a charlatan. The view he takes in his earlier videos is very much some parts were good, some parts bad, overall life was fine, but there has been a steady slide into sensationalistic anti.
Don't you love these comments? They're so passionate. It's like adding some spice to my bland, long and boring videos. Thanks again, Lisa from Finland. Was helping me on these comments. So today we're going to talk a little bit more about Soviet retail. And if you're new to my channel, I cover this topic in quite detail. There's a separate playlist on my channel called Soviet Retail, and I strongly recommend to watch those videos as well. As the part of this story, we're also going to touch the topic of Soviet passport and propiska. And if when I said propiska and you had no idea what I'm talking about, I strongly recommend to check my other video when I in detail described propiska. But before we begin, it's time for the lesson of the Russian language. Урок русского языка. Паспорт. Паспорт. I don't think I need to translate this word. It's passport, obviously, duh. And that was the most important document of every Soviet citizen that you would receive when you turned 16. Паспорт. Прописка. Прописка. You can't really translate this word, but every Soviet citizen was required to be registered or, as we say, sign in. So, прописать, it's to sign in someone at this address of your residence. And you will get an ink stamp in your passport with your прописка. So, that's where people see where you live, where you registered. So, today we're going to analyze this interesting photo, and our lesson of Russian language still is going on. So let's take a look at this interesting picture. So on the left, that young fellow with bright red cheeks, he's покупатель. Покупатель. He's a customer. Покупатель. And on the right, lady in white, she's sitting at the cash register, касса. So she's not actually a seller. She is кассир. Кассир. So she is the clerk at the cash register. Кассир. So what we got here is a customer, покупатель, shows кассир, a clerk, his passport. Покупатель показывает кассиру свой паспорт. So what we got here is the failure to communicate. So here's a million ruble question. Why, oh why, a customer needs to show his passport to the clerk? Now, you're welcome to pause the video and post your comment. And then in the end of the video, we're going to compare how close you got to the right answer. First of all, you need to remember that our passport was the most important document for any Soviet citizen. So we didn't just carry it with us every day because it'll be quite a painful process if you lose it and trying to restore it. We usually hid our documents, our passports, along with the birth certificate, just like Americans keep their social security cards somewhere in a safe place at home. They don't keep them in their wallets. Same way, we didn't carry our passports on a daily basis, only for special occasions. So here, our first clue. This purchase was quite important if the young fellow brought his passport to show the clerk. So it's interesting already, right? So at the time of recording this video, I can only assume, I can only make an educated guess. So some of you who paused the video and wrote their comment, you're probably thinking he brought his passport to prove his age so he can purchase alcohol, right? Which is kind of makes sense. And a lot of people, former Soviet people, in discussion under this picture claimed exactly the same thing. He shows the passport to show he's old enough to buy alcohol. Personally, I don't believe so, and let me explain you why. But if you take a close look, it appears that a passport opens somewhere in the middle, not in the beginning where you have your date of birth. So what's in the middle of the passport? prapiska. So why in the world would this guy show his prapiska in his passport in the grocery store? So now we need to talk about Soviet retail, big picture. Imagine you're a tall person, like I don't have to imagine I'm 6 foot 2 inches. In high humidity conditions, I'm 6 foot 3 inches. So I had experience when a blanket is too short for me. So when you try to keep your head warm, your feet will get exposed, be cold, right? And vice versa. So you constantly pull this blanket back and forth. Kind of similar situation existed in Soviet retail. We did not have enough goods and groceries for the whole country to supply with like red plenty. So Soviet government had to make hard choices. Just kidding, there was no hard choice. Soviet government was located in Moscow. So Moscow got the priority in getting groceries and other goods. And it made sense because most foreign tourists, when they arrived to Soviet Union, they probably 90% came straight to Moscow or Leningrad. So we had two storefronts for the Soviet Union, Moscow and Leningrad, now it's called St. Petersburg, that were getting pretty much all the goods they needed. So those grocery stores had a good supply. They were stocked with items that you would have hard time finding just 100 kilometers out of Moscow. So after Moskva and Leningrad, down the food chain, that would be Kiev, the hometown where I grew up, capital of Ukraine, Minsk, capital of Belarus, and so on. So that will be second priority. And then whatever left will be delivered to the smaller towns. And then in the end of it will be villages, like a village that I grew up in northern Ukraine. We had bread delivered there only 3 times a week. It was instantly sold out. And shelves were pretty much bare, besides some basic items like cigarettes and matches, sugar, salt, which were sold in bags, like you buy by kilogram. There was hardly anything on the shelves. Well, it sounds like an optimal solution, right? Well, not really if you consider the human factor, because people from surrounding areas figure out pretty quick that just, 5 hours away, there's a plenty of food at the grocery stores. So people started traveling to Moscow, to Leningrad by train, mostly because hardly anyone owned a car. And surrounding area, I mean, some people took overnight train, so they will arrive to Moscow early in the morning, do their shopping, then hop on a train, and once again, overnight trip back to their hometown. So picture, like, if people in Michigan will be traveling to Chicago or Detroit to buy basic groceries. People do travel to Chicago to do shopping, but because there is some stores that they just don't exist anywhere else, only in the big cities, here, just for basic groceries, people would travel on overnight train. And such trains got a nickname, kolbasnoy poezd, или kolbasnaya elektrichka, sausage train, or sausage. Elektrichka is like an electric suburban train. And that was actually a joke. It sounds like this. What is it? It's long, it's green, and it smells like a sausage. And the answer, that's electric suburban train from Moscow, or it's a train from Moscow. So people traveling loaded with groceries, that the whole train smells like sausage. So once again, we have this Soviet cat and mouse game when government found solution to supply big cities with goods, and then people from small cities found a solution to get themselves supplied. So once again, sounds we got this interesting situation, and once again, we need to look at the human factor. So picture if you Moskvich, Moscovite, so you live in Moscow or some other large city, Leningrad, Kiev, and you go to the grocery store and shelves are empty because over the weekend, people from out of city came and bought out everything. Or you come to the grocery store and there's a huge line and you realize all the people are not from your neighborhood. They actually came from far away and you're buying your groceries. So of course you'll get upset and of course you will try to find some solution to fix that problem. So finally, after this long detour, we come back to our main photo, main character. So this is what I think guy is doing. He's showing his prepiska. So he shows the cashier lady at the casa that he's a local guy. He lives right here, so he has the right to purchase the goods. So this is what people in Moscow and Leningrad came up with. They began requesting proof that you live in the area. And it came so localized. So if, for example, if you live in the next district, you won't be able to buy groceries in the other one. They just try to lock their goods in specific areas. And I think this is what happened in this photo. He proves that he is a local guy. He shows his prepiska. So once again, imagine you arrive to Mall of America. I think it's the largest mall in the United States and probably in the world. And you're trying to buy something and they ask you to show driver's license and they'll tell you, hey, you're not local. You can't buy these goods, or you're limited to purchase only one item per person or something like that. Sounds pretty crazy, right? And those limits, they were up to local authorities. Sometimes there was just limit the amount you can buy. So like if, for example, you're only allowed to buy only half of kilo of butter if you're not from this area, if you're not from this neighborhood, right? You think it's a bad neighborhood, like that joke goes. But they actually come up with a better system because people didn't like carry their passports around. As I said, it was really important documents, just like for American Social Security card. So there was a different solution. In Moscow, since that was the place they had the most problem with out-of-town customers, they came up with карточка покупателя. So there's a customer ID with the photo. It shows the proof that you're local and you're allowed to purchase goods at a specific store. So карточки покупателя was the Moscow solution for the problem of out-town people scooping up their goodies. As a person who was born and grew up in Kyiv, capital of Ukraine, my family never had to travel to Moscow to buy groceries because Kyiv was supplied pretty well. But still, every time we would travel up north to our village to stay there for the summer vacation, we were always carrying full bags of groceries up there because we knew that local grocery store would have pretty much nothing besides just basic goods, like I mentioned, bread, salt, sugar. There was really not much stuff, so we had to bring our own groceries for that month. And when I say groceries, I mostly mean sausages, like kielbasa, the kielbasas, because in the village we had plenty of like milk, of course, because my grandparents had a cow. We had eggs because they had chickens. They had a pig, so there was pork and salo. So the basic groceries that foodstuffs that my grandparents had, it was okay, but some items that we liked but couldn't get at the local grocery store, we had to bring with us. And I just want to add that even for people who grew up in the Soviet Union, this topic of shortages in the stores and requirements to show your prepiska or have a customer ID and how bad it was or how good it was, it's still a hot debated topic. It blows my mind. Sometimes I have a feeling that people grew up in a different Soviet Union because some people are like, yeah, this is what we had to do. Even to purchase socks, I had to bring my passport. And others claim that, no, we had plenty. What are you talking about? So it's interesting. I believe some people have like amnesia. They just try to remember, or they just remember the good stuff and they don't remember anything else. But there's plenty of pictures that prove that people did have to show their passports buying basic groceries, that had customer IDs issued to limit access to the grocery stores or other type of stores. So that's pretty interesting situation. Okay, so before I finish this story, and I hope you enjoyed it, don't forget to like this video. I want to add a quick comment about countless pictures of long lines by the stores that I believe mostly foreign tourists took, because there's not a single Soviet person would waste its film taking pictures of a long line by the grocery store. I mean, like, this is like everyday occurrence, so who cares, right? I think most of those lines, they prove not the shortage of goods, because as I said, in Moscow they had hardly any shortage, it's just that people from out of town were shopping. Picture Chicago and a long line for Chicago. There's a place that has a famous popcorn, Garrett's, I believe. If you see that long line, would you take picture of it and then post on Instagram, look, there's a horrible shortages of popcorn in America? No, it's just people from out of town. They come and to have a taste of this famous Garrett popcorn. Same in New Orleans. There is always a long line. I can't say the name of that food item. Beignet. The specific place has a huge multi-hour line for the same reason. It's out-town people want to have a taste of that. Something in Savannah, Georgia was a long line for some famous local ice cream. So a lot of those pictures that you saw, there was actually out-town people shopping in Moscow. So for specific location for Moscow, it's not the proof of shortages. It's just the proof of that out-town people were shopping. Well, I hope you enjoyed this video and learned something new. I want to say once again, thank you so much to my patrons who support me on the patreon.com. I will be making specific videos just for you guys. They will have a private access, and what I decided I'm going to do, I'm going to read you my new book, 1996 American Diaries, which I'm in progress of translating, but I got it ready. About 100 pages ready to go. So as a thank you for your support, I'll be making videos with comments and photos just for you on patreon.com. And on this note, I want to say goodbye, до свидания, and we'll talk to you soon. Thank you for watching Ushanka Show. Спасибо за просмотр канала Ushanka Show. Thank you. And if you love my channel and would like to show your support, please click on the link below this video and become the patron of the Ushanka Show. For as little as $1, you can help us grow and create the new interesting videos about the life